Hey there, everybody. Pete Pardo here from Sea of Tranquility. Welcome to another edition of Questions and Answers. Today is Saturday, April the 13th. It also happens to be Record Store Day. If you have a local record shop in your area, get on down there. Join in on the fun. Buy some records. Buy some music. Just be part of the whole experience. I know they're usually a lot of fun. If you live in the Hudson Valley, New York area, go visit Rock Fantasy in Middletown, New York. Steve Keeler's got a whole big thing going on there today. Lots of fun, lots of new stuff that's only available today. And go and check it out. So we have another episode. This is actually going to be, and I mentioned this not long ago, earlier this week, this is going to be the last episode of the Questions and Answers show as we know it. Okay, it's not going away. But the format's got to change. Because, quite frankly, the last, four, five, six episodes have been kind of a chore for me. Not just the fact that it takes forever to do these, okay? So just so you guys understand, I get anywhere from 150 to 200 questions on each episode, right, that I got to sift through. A lot of them I have to do research on because you guys are, it's like everybody's trying to stump me, right, to find the most obscure bands in the world to see if I've heard of them. If I haven't heard of them, listen to them and what do I think of them, right? So it takes a lot of time. And probably, I wouldn't say half, but close to half the questions we're getting lately are either rehashes of questions we've already answered or questions that are being answered in the same show that you guys are commenting on. So I get it. An hour and a half long show is a lot to get through and sit through. But if you're not going to watch these shows and hear what's being asked and what's being answered, then why are you commenting? Okay, so something had to give here a little bit, right? Because half of my Saturday or Sunday is taken up trying to do this show. And, with the nicer months coming up, I just don't have the time to dedicate to something like this with all the other shows that I'm doing, my day job, stuff with the family, all that kind of stuff. So here's what we're going to do going forward. Obviously, today we're going to keep the same format. But going forward, starting with the next episode, continue to give your questions, all right, as you normally do. Think very hard about the questions you're asking, okay? Ask me questions that relate to the type of genres that we cover, but try and make them questions where I actually have to sit and think about them. I can maybe use my experience to form an opinion, bring up some discussion, right? Enough of this. Pete, can you do a show on this band? Pete, can you do a show on this album? Pete, who's the most underrated guitar player? Pete, who's the most underrated band? This type of thing. Questions about punk and new wave and, the stuff that, I don't specialize in. Try and think of questions that are very relevant to the Sea of Tranquility world, right? That can actually get me to stop and think and talk about for a few minutes, okay? And how we're going to work this is I'm going to go through the questions and I'm going to pick 10 each week. That's all I'm going to do. Each episode is going to be 10 questions, 10 answers, all right? We're looking to shoot this, 30 minutes, 45 tops, all right? 30 minutes is what I'm looking at because these hour and a half long marathons just have to end, right? So that's how we're going to do. And as we're going through the questions today, I'm going to really point out some of the ones that I'm kind of, what I want you guys to kind of hit on, all right? So when I see a really good question here, and we had some really good ones in last week's episode. So if you go back to last week's and you get some, check out some of the questions and answers that I gave where I really had to stop and think, and I went into like a minute or two long little ramble about, whatever the topic was. That's the kind of stuff we're looking at, all right? Not Pete, have you ever heard this band? Yes, I have. They're great. Next, nobody really gets anything out of that, right? So let's get started here for today. So keep that in mind for next week's show. So we're going to do about 10 questions max every show going forward. I'm going to pick the questions out of all the stuff that you list. So really think twice and hard about what you're going to put in there if you want to get your stuff covered, all right? So from IndieCult777, hi, Pete. Thanks for doing the Gary Moore Thin Lizzy shows. Your co-host was great. That's Butch Jones. Yes, he is. My questions this week. I know you're a big Wings fan, but how do you feel about McCartney's post-Wings output? In IndieCult's opinion, the 80s, early 90s stuff was spotty at best, but very much enjoy the Flaming Pie on albums. Flaming Pie on albums. Your thoughts. Last question. What is your thoughts of Peter Gabriel's solo output? Okay, so yeah, as everybody knows, I'm a big Paul McCartney and Wings fan. Always have been. Tug of War and what's the, is it coming up? What is that album? That album though, maybe it's just called McCartney. The one that he released like a year after Back to the Egg, the last Wings album. I have those two and I might have one other. I'm not crazy about the McCartney stuff he released after he put Wings to bed. And I really have not kept in touch with anything he's done in probably since the early 90s. So I haven't heard Flame and Pie or any of the more recent stuff, you know, other than like a track or two here and there. Hasn't really done a hell of a lot for me. You know, for me, if I want to hear McCartney, I'm going to listen to all the 70s Wings stuff or the Beatles stuff. That's you know, where I'm at with that. As far as Peter Gabriel's solo output, you know, I mean, I love most of his stuff. The 70s stuff after he left Genesis is fantastic. I like most of the 80s output. I'm trying to think, God, when was the last album he did? I haven't listened to his last couple. But I just like Peter Gabriel a lot. I always have. He's got a very unique voice, and his music kind of touches on a lot of different things. It's very thoughtful, and so I always dug his solo stuff. You know, would I have loved if he was stayed in Genesis? Hell yes, but that wasn't to be, and I'm pretty happy with the solo output of Peter. So, arguably, you look at some of these, you compare, Gabriel's solo output to, other guys from, famous prog bands who left and had solo careers. I mean, without a doubt, I think Peter Gabriel's did the best out of all of them, right? You know, without a doubt. From our buddy Spaghetti Lee L. Douchebag. Hi, Pete. Clearly you have a badass t-shirt collection. I think I do. How about a show about some of your favorites? I could do that. Yeah, I guess that'd be kind of fun. Although you guys have seen so many of them already. But yeah, I could do that where I just kind of show them off. Yeah, I'll think about doing that. Do you have vintage tour shirts? Like, in other words, vintage like I've owned them since, like, back in the day? No, man. You know why? Because, like, a lot of the stuff that I bought, like, in the early, mid, late 80s, and a lot of those classic, especially, mostly metal shows that I went to, I wore those things to death and they just, like, disintegrated. However, I have... in recent years, last 15, 20 years, I have bought a lot of shirts that are replicas of a lot of those vintage tours and things like that. So I do have quite a bit of those too. But I mean, I love these shirts. They're great. You've got Joe Bonamassa here today, a little, nice little Gibson. I went out about, I don't know, 8 months ago or so and got some offer on the internet where they had all these kind of cool Gibson Les Paul shirts with various like famous Les Paul players. So I bought a whole bunch of those and I dig them quite a bit. So I love Les Pauls. Also, quick question from Spaghetti Lee. Why are the Clash so damn overrated? Come on. The whole overrated and underrated thing is just, it's so subjective, right? I don't dislike the Clash. I like a handful of their tunes, fairly much. I know some people think they're the greatest thing ever. Some people think they're awesome. I mean, awful. I don't honestly think a lot about the Clash. They're okay. If I listen to the Clash once a year, that's probably a lot. But, deserve all the credit they've gotten because I think, some good albums. They were very popular, obviously. It affected a lot of people, influenced a lot of people. So, I wouldn't say they're overrated. I don't know. But it's up to the listener, right? From Arnaud B. Hey, Pete, are you familiar with the Italian prog label Alt Rock? They signed some of the best current prog bands like Not a Good Sign, Humunculus Rest, Camembert, Eugen, Bresny Fun Club, and last but not least, SKE and their Sublime 1001 Autunni. A wonderful label. Yeah, we on the website, on www.seatranquility.org, the webzine, we for years used to get all the new alt-rock stuff. They would send us the CDs, we review them. So if you go onto our website, we have reviews of a ton of the more modern prog bands on that label, although they have not, and are they still around even? Because I haven't gotten anything from them in ages. It's been easily 5 years, right? And they just kind of, maybe they're just not sending out, review copies anymore. That could be it. But I have not heard from them. Like I said, we covered a lot of their stuff. A lot of really good bands, right? The ones you mentioned, Eugen is probably one of the one that kind of stands out for me. I like them quite a bit. So yeah, if you haven't checked out the Alt Rock label, again, I don't know if they're still around. I'm assuming they're still around. A lot of good bands there. A lot of good bands to investigate. Very, very underground stuff though, but very cool. From Lisa T. All right, your T in my book stands for Tull. Lisa's a big Jethro Tull fan. She asks me Tull questions every week. So I was going to ask you, what is the most underrated and overrated Jethro Tull album was? But I see you have a question for me. I actually asked her a question on last week's show. So I'll ask that instead. What are your favorite bands that had Jethro Tull members in them? Hope that works. Okay, before I get to that, I'm going to answer your question. All right, again, I hate doing the overrated, underrated thing, but I, in this instance, I will. For me, the most overrated Tull album, I've always thought, it's one of my bottom three least favorites, is Too Old to Rock and Roll, Too Young to Die. I just never liked that album. I just think that's kind of like a lightweight album. Yeah, a couple good tunes, but I don't know, man. So many more powerful albums came before and after it. I never understood all the hoopla for that album. And I just, for me, you know, other than like Under Wraps and .com, that probably sits down there. You know, it's in the bottom five easily for me. As far as underrated, an album which I think is great and not a lot of people talk about it is Stormwatch. Stormwatch is a terrific album. Yeah, it's kind of dark and menacing and doesn't have that kind of whimsical flair that a lot of, you know, especially like Songs from the Wood and Heavy Horses has. But man, some great songwriting on there, some epic playing and arrangement. So I never understood why more people don't like absolutely love Stormwatch. But anyway, that's your questions as far as now. The question for me, which I actually gave you, all right, so what are your favorite bands that had Jethro Tull members or ex-members in them? So probably up at the top for me is Wild Turkey, featuring Glenn Cornick, ex-bass player from Jethro Tull. So he formed Wild Turkey a couple years after he left Tull. Wild Turkey is a fantastic band, folks. A great hard rock band, heavy rock band with lots of kind of, you know, folkish influences, kind of like Tull. If you love Tull, man, you'll love Wild Turkey. You know, the good kind of heavy riffing, you know, and but moments of like kind of tranquil, folky beauty, man, really good stuff. I highly recommend Wild Turkey. Bloodwind Pig, obviously. Mick Abram's band, you know, very bluesy. I think I only have one or two albums of theirs, but I do like Bloodwind Pig. Another Glenn Cornick band, Paris. This was in the later 70s. It's a band he put together with Bob Welch, ex of Fleetwood Mac. Paris is a very good hard rock band. Really good stuff. Check them out. I think they did two albums together. How about John Glasscock, their bass player from the late 70s? The band Carmen, like a proggy, fusion-y, folky band, right? I think most of the members were from Spain. John Glasscock was also in Toe Fat, a late 60s, like heavy blues rock band with Ken Hensley, who later went on to form or join Uriah Heep, obviously. John also was in another band with Ken Hensley called the Gods, okay? Also Lee Kerslake from Uriah Heep, okay? Another pre-Uriah Heep band. Very cool kind of psychedelic, you know, like a proto-prog type of thing. And how about another band with Ken Hensley? Head Machine. So John Glasscock did like three bands with Ken Hensley before the formation of Uriah Heep. Head Machine. Another just one and done album. Very, very cool band. Very Heepish. If you like Uriah Heep, you'll love Head Machine. All right, what do we got next? From Overkilling 84. Have you heard Existence, Rain and Violence album? Excise is a prog band or Lord Bane? I've never heard Existence, Rain and Violence, to my knowledge. Excise, that's pretty good. I think to me they're a little bit more prog metal-ish. And Lord Bane, that's pretty serious stuff. That's very kind of epic, bombastic, progressive metal. Good stuff. From Ian McLennan. Hi, Pete. What do you think of the supergroup called The Aristocrats featuring Guthrie Govan, Brian Beller, and Marco Miniman? Absolutely stellar jazz rock fusion. Yeah, I got to agree there. And sadly, all right, because I've heard a lot of their stuff here and there over the years. Sadly, I don't own anything by them, and I am going to rectify that immediately. So thank you so much for your question, and that reminded me to get my shit in order and get some Aristocrats, because those three players are some of the best out there today. I mean, Guthrie is a phenomenal guitar player. Brian is an amazing bass player, and we all know how fantastic Marco is. And I love that kind of instrumental jazz rock fusion proggy thing, right? So that's what they do so well. So yeah, I'm going to get a couple of their albums immediately. From Andrew G. Dick, hey Pete, do you know any good interview videos of various rock stars on YouTube that are worth watching? You know what it is, Andrew? I'm so busy, man. I don't have a lot of time just to constantly be surfing YouTube and looking up interviews. I may stumble upon one every so long, and a second the part of his question here is he's recommending Rick Wakeman's Wonderful Stories interviews he did about 10 years ago with Iommi, John Lord, Brian May, and Ian Anderson. Well worth watching. Yeah, I've seen the Iommi one. Yeah, I mean, Wakeman is just such a character, right? So I've seen a few of those. Those are a lot of fun. But yeah, I don't go like looking up interviews. You know, sometimes they come up in my YouTube feed on my recommendations. If I see something that looks interesting, I'll click on it and watch a little bit of it. But man, I'm just so busy. You know, I wish I had more time to just kind of, because YouTube is an amazing place. I mean, you ever just, I'm sure everybody has, you probably do it with my channel here, but you ever just like go on YouTube to watch something specifically, and then like 5 hours later, you look at the clock and you're like, holy shit, I've been watching 5 hours worth of videos, and you just start watching all this stuff. It's crazy. It's like drugs, man. Ugh. From Jonas Halberg. Hey, Pete, what's your thoughts about Chris Goss and Masters of Reality? Man, I haven't thought about that band in a million years. In fact, I saw them live. God, who did they open up for? Was it Down? They might open up for Down. I don't know. I saw them at a club here in Poughkeepsie, New York at The Chance. They opened up for some band I saw a long time ago. Might have been Down. I think it was, like, geez, Corrosion Conformity maybe? I don't know. It was a long time ago. They're a good band. They just kind of dropped out of the spotlight, though. I haven't heard anything from them in ages. But, you know, good kind of like stoner desert rock stuff. I always thought they're a pretty solid band. From Steve Bernier. Hey, Pete, Stephen Wilson has been remastering our favorite and his two classic prog albums from ELP, King Crimson, Gentle Giant, Yes, and once a year, the Royal Treatment for the Jethro Tull album sets. Do you think he is the musical genius some say he is? And are these the definitive versions of the albums he has remastered to now own? Oh, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say, yes, I think he is a genius, okay? That guy's done a lot of great stuff. And as much as he tries to push himself away from the prog rock tag, he's just always involved in it, right? Whether it's the shit that he's producing himself and recording himself, or the, you know, albums he's remastering and remixing. I mean, come on, he's right in the middle of it. I mean, he told me to my face, like at Nearfest, what year was that? 2001? I'm trying to remember. I interviewed him at Nearfest, and he, nice guy. But he told me, he goes, yeah, I don't really think of myself as a prog musician. I don't really associate Porcupine Tree with prog and all that kind of stuff. And I'm like, what, are you kidding me? You know, that's, and he said that numerous times over the years. He really tries to distance himself. But obviously, he's in the thick of things. As far as like all these remixes, remasters, are they definitive? I mean, no, the definitive is the original recordings. However, some of these are, you know, they take that definitive recording to a new level or a different level. It's just a variation. So, you know, there have been a couple of them that I heard. I'm trying to think of which ones. God, I've heard so many of the Stephen Will. He's done a fantastic job on a couple of the King Crimsons, which I like a lot. And I don't think I've heard any of the Yes ones that he's done. I've heard a couple of the Tulls. I mean, I think the Aqualung is great. A couple of Gentle Giant ones are very good too. You know, but it's hard to call them definitive. It depends on what you like, right? Some people are always going to like those original recordings. Some people are going to like the fact that he has kind of brightened up some of these, given some of the, you know, the passages some space, added some different elements in there. You know, it depends on what you like. I would hesitate to call any of them definitive, right? Because we know what the definitive are. But are they great, many of them? Yeah, hell yeah, they are. Steve also says, I think his music with Porcupine Tree is magnificent, and his solo work, The Raven That Refused to Sing and Hand Cannot Erase, are prog masterpieces, in my honest opinion. I mean, yeah, great modern prog stuff. I agree. Really good stuff. I'm a fan of Mr. Wilson. From Alan Joyce, hey, Pete, I was wondering, which are some of your favorite opening tracks on albums, and can you think of any albums that could have been sequenced better to make the whole flow more balanced? I mean, the second part of your question, dude, I'd have to go through and really look at a lot. None come off the top of my head, you know. But I'm sure there's quite a few that I can come up with where it's like, you know, the front end is so strong and the back end is like kind of peters out. There's a lot of that, but off the top of my head, I can't think of any right now. But as far as great album openers, I mean, how about Stand Up and Shout from Dio, Holy Diver, right? Neon Nights from Heaven and Hell, Black Sabbath. The title track to Black Sabbath from the first album. Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath, title track to that album, okay? Great album openers. Where Eagles Dare, the first song from Peace of Mind by Iron Maiden. The Halion / Electric Eye, I always kind of think of them as one tune from Screaming for Vengeance. And how about Painkiller from Painkiller, another Priest classic. Fight Fire with Fire from Metallica, Ride the Lightning, that's killer. How about Watcher of the Skies from Foxtrot by Genesis. I mean, if that isn't one of the best progressive rock openers ever, I don't know what is. Deep Purple's Burn, right? One of my favorite tunes of all time. What a great album opener. Speed King from In Rock. How about the Immigrant Song from Led Zeppelin 3? Right? And how about the little thrash stuff? How about Angel of Death by Slayer? Right? So there's some good, a lot of good album openers, man, that just kind of grab you by the throat as soon as you drop the needle or hit the play, right? From Gear Latin Lad. Are you a fan or own any of Eric Johnson's music? If so, what albums? And could you list your top 10 favorite instrumental guitar players? All right. And then he says, P.S. Nobody expects the Metal Inquisition. I don't know what that means. Anyway, as far as Eric Johnson goes, I have Tones, Avia Musicom, Venus Isle, and the Up Close album. Plus, I also have the, if you haven't heard it, you should check it out. He was in a band before his solo career called the Electromagnets, which were like an instrumental jazz fusion band. Really good stuff. Check that out. I have that. It's very good. As far as like my favorite instrumental guitar players, and you know, I hesitate to include Eric Johnson in this list because a lot of his stuff has vocals, and a lot of these guys have done vocals on and off. But you know, Steve Vai is the top of the list. I love Vai. You know, I love a lot of the older Satriani stuff. The Steve Morse band. One of my favorites. I mean, I love Morse in Deep Purple, and I loved him in the Dregs. But man, those a lot of those Steve Morse band albums are sizzling instrumental guitar rock. Jeff Loomis, formerly of Nevermore, now doing the instrumental thing, quite good. Tony McAlpine, his early stuff, fantastic. Sean Lane, Christ, that guy is awesome. I don't know how I didn't get into him back in the day, but man, I am enjoying the hell out of him now. Some of that early Jason Becker stuff, Marty Friedman as well. Buckethead. I don't own any Buckethead other than, was that band Praxis? I own a couple of Praxis albums, but I don't own any of the Buckethead solo albums. But I've been hearing my buddy Jeff Young, ex-Megadeth guitar player, jeffyoungjams.com, Music Without Boundaries. He has been playing me a lot of and tossing a lot of Buckethead stuff my way, and I got to tell you, I really dig it. So, really liking Buckethead. Andy Timmons. Okay, Guthrie Govan, obviously, right? So a lot of good instrumental guys out there, and there's a ton I haven't didn't even mention. From Music Matters, Pete, you said Virgin Steel weren't groundbreaking, which I agree, but are there any newer bands you feel are in fact groundbreaking? I mean, that's a tough question. It's how hard is it to be groundbreaking after all the greatness that we've seen for the last 50 years, right? You know, a couple bands for me kind of spring to mind. Bands, I think, that kind of set a trend and started something new, and you know, when they first came out, and I'm talking since like, you know, 90 or so, 90, 95. I think Opeth were very groundbreaking. You know, it's arguable whether they're groundbreaking anymore, but I think when Opeth first came out, you know, I mean, nobody was really doing like combining death metal with like folk and prog and psych. I mean, nobody was doing that, right? And there's a ton of classic Opeth albums where they just kind of kept pushing the boundaries of that. So I think Opeth definitely were one. Dream Theater, for crying out loud. Come on. They were not the first progressive metal band, but they were the band that kind of combined like strong, you know, like 80s metal hooks with really challenging musical passages and heavy, heavy arrangements, right? And they opened the doors for so many other bands. I mean, come on. Say what you want about Dream Theater, but you can't tell me that Images and Words and Awake and Scenes from a Memory, I mean, come on. Those are just killer albums. So many bands came in the wake of those, you know. Mastodon, I think, were a pretty groundbreaking band. You know, they kind of started as a hardcore band. Then they took on all these prog elements and hard rock elements and just really did something totally different. And I think Enslaved are pretty groundbreaking, you know, for a black metal band from the original kind of Norwegian pack of them that came out in the early 90s. These guys have evolved, you know, they added lots of prog and space rock into their black metal sound, and they're doing shit that no other bands are doing or have done in the past. So those are four bands that I think are pretty groundbreaking. And I'm sure there's more, but, you know, not a ton because a lot of bands just kind of mimic each other, you know. From Professor Whiskey Breath. I like that name. Great Q&A show. What's your thoughts on the band Black Mountain? I have the first CD, but nothing after that. I thought the first one was pretty good. Thanks for the channel. Thanks to you. My bank account is lighter than it should be. Keep it up. That's what it's all about, right? Spreading the love of music and hopefully introducing some cool new stuff to people who have never heard them before. As far as Black Mountain, I've heard some stuff from the Black Mountain 4 album, which I think came out in 2016. I dig them, right? It's kind of stonerish, kind of like Sabbath meets Pink Floyd a little bit. They're a pretty cool band. A lot of cool bands like that out there that kind of do that kind of like stoner doom thing, but they got lots of prog and psych elements. And they're one of them, all right? It's from David M. Pete, thanks for answering all my questions and offering your takes on a variety of bands. What is your take on the following three bands? Theocracy, Veni Domini, and Pagan's Mind. I love all three. I think that Theocracy managed to be one of the few U.S. bands that really captures the European power metal sound. Yeah, but is Theocracy like doing anything anymore? It seems like they released like one or two albums and that's been it, right? But that first one's very good. I remember like when we first started up the Sea Tranquility webzine back, you know, in the early 2000s, I remember that Theocracy album was fairly new at the time, and a bunch of our writers were big, big into them. In fact, I think Mike Popke, who still writes for Sea Tranquility, was a huge, huge fan of that album. And I own it. That's a very good album. I think they've done another one since then, but I don't know. But yeah, it's very good. I mean, it's basically like a one-man band, right? Very, very well done. Very melodic. Captures all those, you know, kind of power metal and bits of prog metal. Very, very good. Veni Domini is very good. I have, I think, two, and I don't know how many, again, another band that I got into like in the late 90s, early 2000s, and I haven't heard anything from them in a million years, but I have two of their albums. Really good, kind of like progressive doom, kind of like Candlemass, but with a little bit like shred guitar and a little progressive elements. Really good stuff, heavy stuff. And Pagan's Mind are awesome. Pagan's Mind, to me, I think, I don't classify Pagan's Mind as power metal. They're more progressive metal band. Pagan's Mind are fantastic. I mean, that's some classy shit right there. Great vocals, great arrangements, catchy hooks, sizzling musical interplay, man. Pagan's Mind are fantastic. In fact, they are overdue for something, right? From Garrett Munton, two questions. What is your favorite lineup from Alan Holdsworth's solo albums? Well, you know, I kind of prefer that like early 80s stuff. Specifically with Chad, for me, I love Chad Wackerman sitting behind Holdsworth. There's something about Chad Wackerman's drumming on Alan Holdsworth albums or live that just really works for me. So, you know, you got the Road Games album, which had Chad and Jeff Berlin, which that didn't last long enough, but that's a pretty formidable lineup right there. But then like Metal Fatigue, and I think they did a couple other albums together and lots of tours together. You had Jimmy Johnson and Chad Wackerman with Holdsworth, and Jimmy Johnson and Wackerman work really, really well together. That might be the one I lean to because they had the most time together with Holdsworth. That's a great rhythm section to sit behind Holdsworth. So that's what I'm going to go with. So Holdsworth, Jimmy Johnson, and Chad Wackerman. Good lineup. Question number two. Have you heard an album by pianist Gary Brunot called Yesterday's Dream? It features Jimmy Johnson. There we go. Eric Marienthal and Bill Berg, kind of like Chick Corea. Yeah, I had never heard him before, but I went and listened to that album, Yesterday's Dream, before we went on air. That's quite good. Yeah, it reminds me of the Electric Band. I dig it quite a bit without the, like, you know, the Gambale guitar stuff. But the Marienthal, Eric Marienthal has like such a signature sound, and you know he is like always meant so much to the Chicory Electric Band sound that when I listened to this Yesterday's Dream album by Gary Brunot, it immediately took me back to that because of Marienthal's cool sax melodies and what have you. So and Gary kind of does some Chicory-ish things on the piano. So yeah, thanks for that recommendation. That was pretty cool. From Brian Schlede, what's up, Brian? Hey, Pete, after reading the review on the SOT site, I went out and purchased the Bucket List CD. Glad someone that goes to the website and reads our reviews. Awesome. Good for you, Brian. Yeah, that Bucket List CD is quite good, right? Is there any other Phil Keaggy CDs that you would recommend? You know, I don't own any Phil Keaggy like solo stuff, but what I do recommend, a little bit different, okay? Check out this band he was in the 70s called Glass Harp, kind of like a Christian prog / hard rock / folk band. Very good. I have a couple of their albums on CD, the self-titled Glass Hammer, It Makes Me Glad, Synergy, and Live at Carnegie Hall. In fact, if you want to just kind of sample them first, get the Live at Carnegie Hall album, which is quite good. Very good live performance. And if you really dig that, and you know, some of the tunes that are on there are on the other albums, but if you really like that, go get the studio stuff. But man, Phil Keaggy could burn back in the day on his, I think he played Gibson Les Paul back up during that show at Carnegie Hall in New York City. And there's some rocking stuff on there, some proggy stuff, some jamming, little folky things. Very good. Very good stuff. From David Auerbach, I'm a big fan of 70s and 80s era Heart. I love the Little Queen album. You haven't mentioned them much. What do you think of them? Ann Wilson is one of the best vocalists in rock. Dude, are you not watching the channel? Or maybe you posted this song, posted this question earlier. But I did a whole top 10 songs from Heart the other day. Check it out. It's on the channel. I just did it on Thursday. I love Heart. Okay. Love all their old stuff. Dig a lot of their 80s stuff. I love their more recent stuff. I'm a big fan. From Jimmy, Carabineris. How about a Pat Benatar best to worst or top 10? Dude, you guys have been asking that nonstop. I already said a couple weeks ago, Pat Benatar's on my list of things to do. Top 10 songs. Be patient. From Anthony Ferraro, Pete, are you a fan of TNT Realized Fantasies? Purple Mountain's Majesty is Pure Magic. Fantastic record. I have never heard that album. The only ones I'm familiar with are those first three or four. Definitely the first three TNT albums, which I like quite a bit. I kind of like fell off the map with them and haven't listened to anything they've done in quite a long time. But I will have to go check that out. From Melora Loves Darkness, Pete, your thoughts about Coven, 1967, the first openly satanic death rock band ever. I almost think they are kind of like Renaissance a little bit. I want your thoughts, please. Thank you, always. Yeah, I mean, I own Actually, no, I don't own Coven. I'm thinking about a different band. I have heard the Coven album, though. Yeah, it's... For a band that was like so highly touted to be so satanic and everything, it's like you got these kind of like, yeah, it's very much like, it's very mellow music. It's good. It's kind of like folk music, right? With this, you know, the female singer doing the high-pitched stuff and not very scary. So, yeah, I don't own it. I have heard it. It's amazing how like kind of like, I wouldn't say legendary, but infamous that album is, right? And when you listen to it, because I remember I was so excited to hear that. I was like, oh, cool. I heard so much about this. And I'm like, what is this? This kind of sucks. From Emilio Magnago. Hey, Pete, great shows, man. Congrats. Never heard you talk about Marcus King Band, the best thing in American music in a decade. The heir to Allman Brothers Government Mule Jam Band crown. You know, I got to be honest with you, Emilio. I've heard the name, obviously. And then when I got your question here, I went and listened to a whole bunch of their songs on YouTube, and none of it really moved me, man. It's okay, but man, there's just no fire to a lot of that stuff. I don't hear the Allman Brothers or Government Mule in their music at all. You know, where's all the cool long guitar solos and the kind of funky hard rock stuff and the jamming southern rock? It's good, competent, you know, like kind of rootsy rock. I give you that, but this just... I'm sorry, but it's good for what it is, but to compare them to the Allman Brothers and the Government Mule, man, I think it's, you know, come on. There's just not a ton of fire to that stuff. And maybe live it comes out, but I listen to, you know, I watch some live clips, I listen to a bunch of studio things, and it's all okay, but I don't hear Allman Brothers and Government Mule there at all. You know, so maybe, you know, you go see them live, it's a different story, but based on what I heard, middle of the road, I thought, but again, to each his own, right? From Retro, Pete, do you think all the best songs have already been written? You know, sadly, Retro, I think probably. You know, as far as the best songs, we're still going to get really good songs and potentially great songs. But the best songs, yeah, the best songs have already been done, I think. It's how hard, you know, it's just not easy to come up with something that's just so unbelievably amazing and legendary. They've been done, right? Doesn't mean there won't be good ones, because there certainly are. I hear lots of good ones all the time. But as far as like that song, you know, a song that's going to like move you and be with you forever, you know, how many? That's kind of hard to say. From Charles Picton. Hey, Pete, enjoying your show. What are your top three Maudlin of the Well songs? Mine are number one, Gleam in the Ranks, two, Heaven and Weak, three, Riseth He the Numberless, part two, Thanks. You know, Charles, I only have the Leaving Your Body Map album, which came out like in 2001. And honestly, I haven't listened to that in like a million years. So I couldn't tell you what my top three songs are. That's like I said, it's the only album I've heard. So, and I know a lot of people love that band. And I had a couple friends of mine like, you have to get that album. You have to get that album. And I bought it and I was like, oh, this is pretty good. But it just never really grabbed me like everybody said it was going to. Maybe I just need to revisit because I haven't listened to it in a long time. 10 years, 15 years at least. From Duncan Davies. Hey, Pete, have you heard the new Neil Morse Band album, The Great Adventure? Dude, are you not watching my channel? I just did a new product show like 2-3 weeks ago. And I talked about that quite a bit. Yes. Great album. I love it. Love the Neil Morse Band. Like, love that album. It's a great part two to the Similitude of a Dream. I love both of them. Man, that's some epic prog stuff, huh? From BM Bolts. Great show, Pete. Don't think I have heard you talk about John Butcher. Thoughts? Yes, I talked about John Butcher on like, I think, 2 or 3 question and answer shows ago. I have, or used to have, the Along the Axis album on LP. Don't have it anymore. Haven't heard anything by them in ages. And I remember buying it and I was kind of like, yeah, this is all right. Nothing great. I know some people really dig him. He's a good guitar player, good singer, but I just always found a lot of his material was a little on the weak side. Also, have you heard Four on the Floor featuring Glenn Hughes? Glenn singing disco-style covers. Not great, but Glenn always does a great job no matter what he sings on. You know, I had never heard of this, and I'm a big Glenn Hughes fan. And I saw your question. I'm like, all right, let me go check that out. That is some crazy shit. Glenn Hughes singing disco songs. And I think that was like 78 or 79, if I'm not mistaken, when that album was done. So he's already out of Deep Purple and trying to get his solo career going. And, you know, probably in the midst of cocaine hell, right? So I can only imagine what went on during the sessions for that. But intriguing listen. I don't think I'd ever want to own that. In fact, I thought that one, they do like a melody, a medley of like all a bunch of like Stone songs done like disco with Glenn's doing lead vocals. Bizarre stuff. I urge everybody to go onto YouTube here and seek that out and listen to some of those tunes. I mean, Glenn's a great singer no matter what he does, whether he's doing disco or funk or heavy rock or blues or whatever. But man, it's just weird hearing it. But it was pretty cool. Worth a listen for everybody. From Earl Joy, Peter, you're familiar with the band The Blasters, a great band. Your shows are great, and you've turned me on to so many great artists. Yeah, Earl, I had never heard them before. I went and listened to a bunch of their tunes. It's kind of like rockabilly. It's not really my thing. It didn't do anything for me. Sorry, man. From DC Tune Time, hey, Pete, as we move into summer and travel becomes part of the season, what are the road trip rules in the Pardo household for what gets played? Ours is whoever drives picks the music. I can take anything my wife throws at me mostly. Mostly modern country. Luckily, she doesn't like rap or polkas. For me, I know she cannot tolerate metal, nor much prog. Also, anything with long guitar solos. What say you? I do to you, me? You know, when we're going on like long trips, when we're just driving around town or going close, I leave on whatever I have playing in my thing and I turn it down because my wife is not really into metal and much hard rock and stuff, but it's especially not prog. And yes, she hates anything with long guitar solos, right? Or long keyboard solos, jamming stuff. Nope, sorry. Instrumental stuff, not really into that either. If she's driving, mostly I drive, but like sometimes we'll listen to Spotify and we'll pick like, she'll stream it through her phone, through the car, and you know, we'll pick like a certain artist. There's a lot of artists we like a lot each, so we'll listen to like Elton John or Billy Joel or Styx or Journey or you know, Pat Benatar or Heart or REO Speedwagon or whatever. And I actually don't mind a lot of the the more modern country stuff. I don't mind it. I don't really go seek it out on my own, but like she likes it, and I'll listen to it, and some of it I do enjoy. She also likes a lot of like Spanish music, salsa and things like that. And I don't mind that at all. Rap and hip hop, I do not like. She thankfully doesn't really listen to that stuff. Although occasionally there'll be some hip hop stuff in her playlist and I'll be like, I try to keep the metal to a minimum. So yeah, when we go on any long drives and stuff like that, and definitely nothing with long, crazy guitar solos, you know, cause we'll be sitting there listening to something and she'll look at on the dash and she'll see the song and she'll be like, 12 minutes, huh? When is this song going to be over? That type of thing. So pretty funny stuff. Great question. From Amadeo Eichberg. Please pick preference Pete. Alliteration Festival. Robert Plant. Pictures at 11 versus Principal Moments. God, they're both good. I don't know. I'm going to go Principal of Moments, but I like Pictures at 11. They're both really good. I like them equally. Roger Waters, Pros and Cons versus Radio Chaos. I am not a big Roger Waters solo fan. I don't own either one of those. I don't really care for them, man, to be honest with you. I'm going to not even answer that because I can't give it an honest opinion. I don't own them. I don't know them well enough other than the stuff I've heard. And then David Gilmour debut versus About Face. Both really good. About Face is really, the debut album is very good. It's got some great tunes on it, but man, About Face is pretty killer. I'm gonna go with About Face. From Chris Schrecker, you the man. Love following your updates. What about Italian prog band PFM, otherwise known as Primario? Jesus, I'm drawing a blank. Oh my God, PFM, Primera Fornario Marconi, right? Primera Fornario Marconi. I'm trying to say that right. I'm half Italian. I should know this shit. Any favorite albums? I love PFM. And he says, if you don't have it, check out Jet Lag. It's a good transition between the instrumental workouts and Italianized English vocals. All the best to you. Thanks. Chris, I'm a big fan of their first two albums, the Italian albums. So it's Storia di un Minuto and Per un Amico. Those are great. Really good. And I love the Italian vocals on there. Really lush and kind of romantic. So they went after that, they went and put out the Photos of Ghost album, I believe on, was that ELP's record label, Manticore? I'm trying to remember what label that was on. It doesn't really matter. And what they did was they kind of combined a bunch of those tunes from those first two Italian albums onto. They picked like the best of those two albums, put them on Photos of Ghost, and did them all in English language, English vocals. It's good, but it lost something. Like, I remember when I was first starting to really heavily get into, like, international prog back in, like, the early mid-90s, I kind of gravitated towards Photos of Ghost and, was it World Became the World, I think was the other English language one they did, because I really, at the time, hadn't really accepted, like, vocals in another language yet, right? But the more I started to, like, investigate the PFM, Premiata Fornario Marconi, that's how you say the name. I knew it was going to come to me. The more I started investigating the music of PFM, the more I started to really like the Italian vocals. And then I was like, you know what? Photos of Ghosts is not as good as those first two albums. So those first two are my favorites. Liesola di Niente, which is from 74, is very good also. And then I like the Chocolate Kings album, and I like Jetlag quite a bit. Yeah, Chocolate Kings and Jetlag are a little bit different. They kind of taken on a little bit of more like a fusion-y feel on those. But those early ones with all the mellotrons and Moog synths and piano and acoustic and electric guitar and those lush vocals, ugh, great stuff. Great band. From Thomas Sharpless, on to a question or two, if you don't mind. Like you, I am a huge fan of Uli John Roth's guitar playing, especially from the Scorpions years. I've heard you say that you don't think the Matthias Jabs material holds up as well these days, and I agree with you to a point. However, I think Matthias Jabs has a very distinct style that is underrated. Love Drive Through First, Love at First Sting are fantastic works of melodic hard rock, in my opinion. While Uli is no doubt the superior overall musician between the two, I think the Scorpions would never have become world famous without Matthias. What are your thoughts? I mean, just understand something. My opinion on the Scorpions material has nothing to do with Matthias. He's a great player, a very unique player. And I absolutely agree with you. I think, you know, with Roth in the band, they probably would have never hit the heights that they did, okay? Because Matthias's style was perfectly suited for the more 80s, kind of shorter, more compact, commercial sounding metal stuff that they were doing. I think he's a great guitar player. You know, he's no Roth or Schenker. I'm talking about Michael Schenker, but Matthias is a great player, very unique player, very capable player. So I'm not slagging him at all. I just, for me, like, I have just found as I've gotten older, I gravitate more towards the earlier Uli Roth stuff than I do the 80s material. Although, you know, Love Drive is great. you know, Blackout and Animal Magnetism and Love at First Sting. Probably for me, Love at First Sting is the last great Scorpions album. All the stuff after that, I'm just kind of like hit or miss on. But those are great albums. Number two, what do you think of Pretty Maids? I worked at a record store in the mid-80s where they first came out, but sadly never truly discovered them until 2000's Carpe Diem album. Since then, they've become one of my all-time favorite bands. I've only heard you mention them once or twice on your show. Just curious on your thoughts since we tend to have similar tastes. Yeah, I love Pretty Maids. They are, and in fact, I mentioned this on, I think, the last Q&A show about the new wave of British heavy metal bands. Even though they technically aren't, they were from that time period. I think that Pretty Maids should have been huge. And, you know, especially in the 80s, you know, in the early 90s, because they've had this kind of like very accessible sound that was, you know, kind of metallic, but very AOR, very, a lot of pop elements going on there. And I think the Pretty Maids, like most recent albums, are just fantastic. You know, just a band that should have been huge and just really weren't. And I know they do really well internationally, but I think they should have been really big here. And I, you know, I thought their last couple albums were pretty damn good. So good question there, Thomas. From Jet Powers. Hey, Pete, are you a Bon Scott or a Brian Johnson fan? Oh, man. All right, well, you know, I only started getting into AC/DC with the Back in Black album. And so I always kind of like Brian Johnson quite a bit. But in, you know, later years, I really started to get into a lot of the older stuff with Bon. And, you know, they're both kind of really similar singers, but I just think that, you know, I think Brian is more powerful, but I think Bon brings more kind of character and little nuances to the vocal role in that band. And he was a character, right? And I think if I'm going to have to pick, I'd probably go. And probably Bon is probably a more well-rounded singer with a little more was a more well-rounded singer with a little more range than Brian. You know, Brian's got one style, right? That's it. Bon could do a few other things. You know, neither one were great singers in my opinion. But I'll go with Bon today. All right, that's a great question though, a tough question. From Dante Falzolger, I'm seeing Dream Theater Tuesday night at the Oakdale Theater in Connecticut. Where do you rank their new album with the rest? Well, hopefully you saw my review of the show at the Count Basie Theater in Red Bank, New Jersey, which I attended Wednesday. It was a great show. Go here on the channel. I just posted that the other day. And I think the Distance Over Time is a really, really good album. For me, it's my favorite Dream Theater album, pretty sure, since Mike Mangini joined the band. And I think it's better than any of those last couple that they did with Portnoy. So I rank it up there. I think it ranks pretty high. You know, I think it's better than Systematic Chaos. I think it's better than Black Clouds and Silver Linings, I think. Yeah, so many Dream Theater albums in recent years. And you know, I really like the self-titled album a lot. I also like, you know, Octavarian is good. It's a little overblown. So yeah, I think it's very good. It's I'll put it to you this way. It's the one more recent Dream Theater album that's come out that I think I've really, really, really latched onto quite a bit more than some of the others, and has really kind of ignited a fire in me, an old love for Dream Theater, because Dream Theater was one of my favorite bands for so many years. And then, you know, the last like 5 or 8 years or so, I've just been kind of like, you know, I like their albums a lot. I go see them live. I think The Astonishing totally burnt me out. So I took a little time away from the band. I didn't go see them on the Images and Words Revisited tour. And I totally loved this tour. It was great. And, you know, they played Scenes from a Memory in its entirety once again. And that's my favorite Dream Theater album. So that was great. I love the new songs live. So, I think the new album is quite good. And it ranks up there. From Kim Omaki. As usual, great video. Had an earworm the other day. Couldn't get that Spinners song, I'll Be Around, out of my head. Then I realized it wasn't the Spinners version I was remembering. Instead, it was a memory from a cover by the band What Is This on their 1985 eponymous debut, produced by my hero Todd Rundgren. Any thoughts on this record or I'll Be Around in particular? Never heard it, man. Never heard it, to my knowledge. Late PS, John Wetton sang and played and produced the score LP by Duncan McKay from Cockney Rebel and 10cc. McKay is a phenomenally gifted keyboard guy, in my opinion. I haven't heard that either. Thanks for your question, though. From Bozidar Valentine, your top 5 favorite epic long tracks, 8 minutes and above. Man, there's so many great ones. Without getting too complicated with this, how about Supper's Ready, Close to the Edge, Awaken, and if you don't know, Supper's Ready by Genesis, Close to the Edge, and Awaken by Yes, Stargazer by Rainbow, Child in Time by Deep Purple, and Xanadu by Rush. But man, there's a million of them. I could sit here all day and talk about epic tracks, right? Probably should do a top 20 epic tracks show or something like that. From Robert Presti, hey Pete, thank you for knowledge and continuously expanding our musical horizons. You're welcome. You guys do the same to me as well. You've turned me on to Spock's Beard and Glass Hammer. As a vocalist and guitarist myself, I've always had a deep admiration for Uli John Roth. Yeah, me too. Was wondering if you enjoyed his most recent return to his Scorpions tenure with Tokyo Tapes Revisited and Scorpions Revisited. I've always enjoyed his unique vocal and guitar stylings, and while songs that originally featured Klaus Meine can't ever be truly duplicated, I felt the new vocalist did a remarkable job. What's your take? I've seen Uli twice since he's kind of gone back to start revisiting the Scorpions catalog. In fact, my bachelor party night from almost 11 years ago was actually me and all my buddies went to see Uli John Roth doing a Scorpions set and B.B. King's in New York City, and that was a blast. And I got to meet Uli and hang out with him, and I was hanging out with Alex Skolnick, who was there. Chris Caffrey was there, and you know, got to meet Mark Bowles, who was sang for that show. So I just had such a great time because that for me was the ultimate bachelor party, right? Seeing Uli play all those classic Scorpions tunes plus a few Electric Sun stuff, and it was awesome. So I'm totally happy he's doing this because I love the old Scorpions albums from the 70s. That's my favorite era of the band, and I really, really love that stuff. So I'm very happy he's doing that. Also, Robert says, by the way, would love to see Michael Schenker do something like this as well. Well, he is. In fact, Michael has always done that. So he is out. He's doing the Michael Schenker Fest. He did it last year. He's doing it again this year. I'm going to see him like in a month. And he basically has Gary Barden, Graham Bonnet, Doogie White, and Robin McCauley with them. And all they do is play old classic MSG stuff where those guys sang on. They come out, they sing those songs, right? And they do a bunch of old UFO stuff. And they do some of the new stuff because they did put out a Michael Schenker Fest album last year, which is quite good. And there's another new one coming out. So Schenker has been actually doing that for a while. And Schenker, the last time I saw Schenker was probably like 5 years ago. And he did like 80% old UFO stuff and the rest classic MSG stuff. So, I mean, he's been doing that always, which is great. So if you haven't seen him, go check him out, man. From Pickaxe 3, Pete, would you consider the four most important subjective term I know and legendary metal bands to be Sabbath, Priest, Iron Maiden, and Metallica? What order would you place these four bands in the context of their importance to heavy metal history? Frankly, do you think we'll see a band of this caliber again, and does it matter if we don't? Great show, thanks. You picked some good ones there. So as far as the order of legendariness, Sabbath obviously is top of the list, right? There would be none of these other bands without them. I would put Priest in at number two, okay? As far as number three and four, I mean, my gut tells me to put Maiden, but you just cannot deny the impact of what Metallica did on those first four albums. You really can't. And I think, Maiden obviously has had a much longer and prolific career and really stayed true to form for so many years. I think as far as importance and influence to the genre of heavy metal, Metallica did so much for thrash and heavy music in the 80s. It really did. So I know I'm going to get some flack from people, but I think I'm going to put Metallica just above Maiden, but this is not by much. And it's like, don't make a big deal. There's no way that Metallica is more important to metal than Maiden. Whatever, I'm just saying that Metallica's influence on 80s metal was enormous. Enormous, regardless of what you think of them today and what they've done the last 25 years. This is not a slag on Maiden at all, because I think Maiden were extremely important. And I obviously agree with you. I think those are the four top bands right there on important metal bands ever. Okay, we're not talking hard rock here. We're talking heavy metal. So that's a great question. From David M., I believe you forgot to answer this question from the 4-7 Q&A. Have you heard the Albert Bouchard demos of Imaginos on YouTube? I like both the demo and the official release. What are your thoughts on Buck's solo album flat out? Well, the reason I didn't answer it is because it's been asked before. I've heard the Albert Bouchard demos of Imaginos. Pretty cool, right? Sound a little different. I like the Imaginos album a lot. I don't think it's a true Blue Oyster Cult album. I guess it is. Obviously, the record label thought so. It's a really cool album. They basically took Albert's demos and inserted, the rest of the Blue Oyster Cult guys on them and released it. It's good. I mean, it's good songwriting. It's good storylines. Good stuff. I dig them both, right? Very cool. As far as Buck Darmon's solo album Flat Out, it's good. I own it. I was kind of expecting a little more from it, though. With a player of that caliber, I was kind of really expecting some fire and flash and, crazy stuff going on. And it's good. It's decent. I think it could have been better. From Amica Wolf, what is your take on the Sandmen from Denmark? 99% of folks I know never heard of them. Bloody good heavy rock. Well, I never heard of them either, so I went and listened to a handful of tunes on YouTube here. And I don't know, Amica, I don't find them heavy at all. I don't know where you're hearing heaviness there. To me, they just kind of sound like a very generic modern rock, pop, garage band type of thing. I kept thinking, am I missing something here? I kept listening to another song, another song, another song, another song. I'm like, I don't hear any heaviness on any of these songs. So if they have heavy songs, I didn't hear them. I listened to like five or six tunes, and it sounds like pretty generic stuff to me. But I'm glad you like them. That's all that matters, right? From Robert Stacey, hey, Pete, being a Dio fan, do you own any Elf albums, and how many and your favorites? Well, they only had three studio albums. So yeah, I got them all. Elf, Carolina, County Ball, and Trying to Burn the Sun. They're not great albums. I have them because of the Dio thing, and they're good for what they are. They're kind of like, hard rock and boogie stuff. As far as like my favorite, maybe Carolina County Ball. I don't know. All three are very similar. I wouldn't say any of them are like head and shoulders above the others. They're all solid. Dio sounds good in it, of course, but this is, of course, Dio before he really discovered his true powers. They're more of like a curiosity than anything else in my collection. Every now and then I like to put them on, and I'm kind of like, it's kind of cool to hear, Ronnie with the honky-tonk piano and the kind of boogie rhythms and stuff like that, different. I wouldn't say any of them are essential, but if you're a Dio fan, you got to have them, obviously. From Stephen Race. Hello, Pete Pardo. Thanks again for addressing my questions on your last Q&A show. I really hope you keep getting interesting questions that relate to your show so you can continue this format. I really dig these shows. Well, cool. I know a lot of you feel that way. Some of you I don't think do, and that's kind of where we're making changes here. But all right, so he's asking a question that's kind of been asked for before. He's basically asking what my – and I'm not going to go list all the ones that he lists. You can go online and check them out here. But he's asking what some of my favorite like concert DVDs are, and that's been asked before. I've kind of answered them, but he's asking what are my top 10 rock DVDs. So I'm going to list a bunch of them here. from The Who, I love The Kids Are All Right. Okay, and I love the Isle of Wight Festival concert. Awesome. You've heard me mention this before, Jimi Hendrix at Woodstock. Love it. How about the Woodstock film itself, right? Pink Floyd at Pompeii. Awesome. Deep Purple live in California 74, which is basically the California Jam. Big fan of that. I like a lot of the Deep Purple releases, but I'm not going to sit and list them all, right? From the Wings, Paul McCartney and Wings Rock Show. Great. Rolling Stones, Ladies and Gentlemen. That's awesome. If you love like the early 70s Stones with Mick Taylor, man, that's the one to get. How about that big Led Zeppelin DVD box set that came out? Geez, when was that? Late 90s, early 2000s? You know, that's got all those classic concerts on there. That is awesome. One of my favorites. Opeth has a couple great ones. How about the Roundhouse tapes? This is awesome. The Royal Albert Hall and the Garden of Titans at Red Rock. Great stuff. There's so many. I mean, I could literally do a show where I just, you know, if you could see my stacks of live DVD, concert DVDs I have, it's crazy. I probably should go through and just pick out some more good ones. But yeah, those are some of them that are my favorites, but I have a ton of them. From James Farrar, hey Pete, this one sunk up on me okay to the point. I just gave Government Mule with a little help from our friends live another solid listen today, and what a tight album. I've also heard The Deepest End, so what is your take on them live? I don't know who I like more, Government Mule or the Allman Brothers Band. Six and One Half, Six and Other, your take on those live Government Mule albums. Love your show and thank you for your time. I'm a big Government Mule fan and I'm a big Allman Brothers fan. I've seen the Allman Brothers Band live lots of times with Warren. And I'm a big, big fan of Warren's playing. And I've seen Government Mule a couple times. Awesome. As far as the live albums, man, yeah. I mean, that's one of those bands, their studio stuff is great. It really is. The Government Mule studio stuff is great. But, man, they're a live act, right? So I would say anybody here who's on that has not really jumped into the Government Mule thing and kind of doesn't know where to start, just go get any of their live albums. They've got a bunch of them, right? Fantastic stuff. You know, if you like, the tunes are great. They're a real rocking band, and they just go off on the, you know, Warren just goes, these great guitar solos, man. Just awesome stuff. I can't say enough about Government Mule. Big fan. But yeah, all those live albums are great. The early ones are great. You know, that New Year's Eve one is fantastic from, like, what was that, 1999 or something like that. It's great stuff. From Douglas Dorman. Mr. Pardo, thanks again for answering my questions. I've been mentioned twice now. See that? 70s pop favorites and the Yes album drama. How about your take on Zebra's first album? I think it's astounding. Yeah, I think I've mentioned that before. That first Zebra album was very, very good. Great live band, too. Being the same age, I first bought the Scorpions Animal Magnetism to my high school, blew everyone away. My question on the Scorpions are, did you experience the same all over the place in time frames with this legend? Meaning, wow, there's more. Love Drive, Entrance, Michael, Uli, Matthias. It just seemed as if they were putting out Blackout. I was also discovering Tokyo Tapes, Fun of the Day, so much great new material. And my God, then you realize they have a huge back catalog in the late 60s that was unique and fun, relevant at the time, and even better before. I'll keep ruling. I just got my Sabbath Volume 4 shirt. No question there, just a pride statement. Whew, Doug, my God. So I think what you're getting at here is the first time you discovered the Scorpions and then you realized they had so much great stuff. Yeah, I mean, that the first album I ever got was Blackout. And I remember thinking, wow, this is awesome, right? And then I think the next album I got was Tokyo Tapes, right? And I was like, holy shit, you know, this is amazing. And then I just started scooping up. Then I think I got Animal Magnetism next. And then I got Virgin Killers and Entrance. And I just bought whatever. And then I got Lonesome Crow and just, yeah, all everything. Like Blackout and Back is top notch, and it's all so different, right? But just so cool. And I totally agree with you. It's just something about, you know, discovering like all this great music from this band that you thought were like a brand new band, but they had all this, they had this enormous catalog already, right? You know, it's like Blackout, whoa, great new band. I love the Scorpions. Like, holy crap, they got like, you know, 7-8 albums or whatever it was, you know? It's like, Jesus. So, yeah, very cool. Cool question. from Ben Rogers. Hey, Pete, another great Q&A show. I have a bit of an odd question, but if you could pair a style of beer with all your favorite albums, what would they be? Like, if you could only have one style of beer per album, what would you drink while listening to Deep Purple's In Rock, Iron Maiden, Number of the Beast, Black Sabbath, Paranoid, etc., etc.? Trying to think outside the box a little, but me personally, I feel like dark beer goes good with Sabbath and a nice lager goes well with Judas Priest. Hopefully this question makes sense. Can't wait for your response. That's a silly but great question, Ben. So I get, you know, like if I'm like, let's say it's like this time of year, so spring, early spring, summertime, right? And I'm in the mood to listen to like good, like old fashioned hard rock or maybe southern rock. I want a nice crisp lager or pilsner. That's what I want, okay, for that type of music. If I'm like in a real Sabbath mood, I'm probably looking to reach for a Guinness or a light, you know, lighter stout like that. If I'm just in a metal mood, probably like a sessionable IPA, right? Like a juicy IPA or something like that. And if I'm, you know, I don't normally think of listening to classic prog with beer for whatever reason. So like if I would think like, you know, probably a nice like Pinot Noir or Chianti or something like that for like Genesis or Yes or something like that. So I don't know. It's a fun question. I should probably like take stock of what I normally reach for when I'm, you know, just hanging out, listening to tunes and what kind of stuff I'm actually drinking. I don't think it always has to do with that. I, to be honest with you, I don't think there's like, you know, beer. I think of beer and a style of music. It's just, it'd just be interesting to kind of like document like, well, what did I drink last Friday while I was listening to, you know, whatever. So cool question though. That's thinking outside the box. That's what I like. From Alex Hamilton. Hey Pete, not a question, just a comment, but if you get 10 seconds, I'd like to know what you think. No need to read it out. Well, I'm going to anyway, Alex. The end keyboard solo from Entangled by Genesis is one of the most haunting, emotional pieces of music I've ever heard and my all-time favorite. Would love this to be played at my funeral, but I think it would devastate the family. What the hell? It probably would, but I mean, it is a gorgeous song. It's like, it's not like anybody would be offended by that. I mean, you know, come on, Alex, Mellotron and Moog doesn't get much better than that, right? Tony Banks knew how to combine those two, right? So yeah, I agree. It's a great ending to that song, a wonderful song. From NP, hey Pete, there was a lot of talk about last time the Q&A and it got me thinking. Is there any genre you think has a specific shelf life? By that, I mean a genre that maybe suits a particular time or decade, but perhaps doesn't translate well today. For example, I have a hard time listening to modern prog. I've tried Dream Theater, I've tried Spock's Beer, and I just can't get into them. I'm not sure if it's modern production or whether it feels like they're just trying to ape the old styles of prog. Hope my question is clear, and thanks as always for reading. That's a shame you can't get into modern prog. There's a lot of great stuff. Well, I mean, of course, most of the music today is aping sounds of yesterday, you know? Most of the hard rock bands today are trying to harness that sound of hard rock bands in the 70s. A lot of the metal bands of today are trying to harness the metal sounds of the 80s. A lot of the prog bands are trying to harness the sounds of the 70s. It's just the way it is. Production values are the way they are today, you know? The techniques and technologies are greater today, but you're missing that kind of almost, you know, that organic analog sound of yesteryear. You just got to get past it, man. It's the way it is. As far as like a specific shelf life, I mean, by shelf life, do you mean like popularity? Because let's be frank, prog rock was huge for a handful of years in the early mid 70s, right? That's never going to happen again. There's tons of bands out there, you know, making prog nowadays, and it has levels of success. There's still a lot of people into it, but it'll never be mainstream again, okay? The 80s metal, commercial metal, hair metal, thrash did really, really well throughout that decade. That's never going to happen again. Okay. Metal will always be there. Metal will always be, have a level of popularity and a loyal following. It's never going to be mainstream like that again. Okay. So I'm thinking that's what you're asking here. So it's not so much a shelf life. These genres will always be here. They're always going to be here because there's always going to be people like you and I and our neighbors and what have you who like that stuff, who will, even though we're getting older, we still have a passion for it. We still like it. We'll still reach out for it and listen to it. So it's that there's really no shelf life. Will it be mainstream accepted again? That's the question. Probably not. That's my guess. Okay, because there's always going to be something else coming out that, you know, people are going to jump on the bandwagon. You know, we've had rap and hip hop. We've got, you know, country is all the rage now. And, you know, pop music, you know, whatever calls for pop music nowadays. And everything else that we like kind of gets, you know, blues is always kind of way underground. Jazz has a loyal following, but that's always underground. Metal is now kind of underground. Prog certainly is underground. But they're always going to be there. There's no real shelf life. They're not going anywhere. It's just that the general public may not know much or anything about them. And that, you know what? That's all right. That's okay. From Gene Kirsten. Great show once again, Pete. You are right about REO Speedwagon. They were a great band until after High Infidelity. Rest in peace, Gary Richrath. Yeah, great guitar player. Two bands I really like are Widowmaker from the 70s and Detective. Do you have an opinion on these bands or albums? Thanks. Yeah, I have some stuff on both bands. So Widowmaker, very cool kind of supergroup that I think could have been better. But their first album I have, the self-titled album, very solid. So you got Ariel Bender on guitar from Mott the Hoople and Spooky Tooth, right? You got Bob Daisley on bass. Bob's played with everybody. Hugh Lloyd Langton from Hawkwind. And then Steve Ellis and Paul Nichols on vocals and drums. Self-titled, you know, was released on Jet Records in, what was that, 76? Good, solid album. You know, it's hard rock. It's got some more, you know, more mellower stuff. And it's a decent album. Again, with that talent, though, I kind of expect a little bit more. But it is good. It's worth having. I like it every now and then. I pull that out and listen to that. Detective I liked a lot. So Detective did two albums for Swan Song Records. They were one of the handful of those early bands signed to Led Zeppelin's label. They had the self-titled album. And what was the name? Takes One to Know One. And so you had Michael DeBar on vocals. Of course, he was in Silverhead. Kind of like a glam band. Very good one, I might add. Tony Kay on keyboards from Yes and Badger. Michael Monarch on guitar from Steppenwolf. Bassist was Bobby Pickett. And the drummer was John Hyde from Hocus Pocus. And John actually was also a very good singer, but of course he didn't sing in that band. He just played drums. And I believe he co-wrote a lot of the tunes. I like those albums quite a bit. Very Zeppelin-ish, I always thought. And I listen to those Detective albums. I don't understand why that band wasn't huge. You know, DeBar was a great singer, really good singer. And that album had a lot of really good tunes, especially the debut. Debut is the best of the two of them, but they're both really good. Debut had a lot of really good, like memorable, like Zeppelin style, heavy rock tunes, very epic sounding, good production. I don't know why they just, you know, and again, most of the guys in the band were doing a lot of drugs and they didn't get along that well. So that band just kind of like blew up and disintegrated, you know, before they could really get anywhere. It's a shame. But I just, you know, I don't know how much the label were really behind them because, you know, at the time they had Bad Company, right? And of course, Zeppelin. So Bad Company, I think, is where they put all their efforts. And I think Detective kind of got the shaft a little bit. From Marvel Fan 45, thanks for answering my questions, Pete. You're a great guy. So I really liked Leaf Hound, Armageddon, and Toad. What hard rock albums would you recommend from that? I suck at specifying. Apparently, I will for all other weeks. All right, Marvel Fan, I'm not really sure what you're asking here. So you're asking which albums by those three bands I would recommend, right? I guess, or are you asking what? Hard rock albums like those, what I recommend. I don't really know what you're asking. As far as Leaf Hound, got to get the Growers of Mine. You know, I think I've talked about all three of these bands on. I think what you do, because Marvel Fan has asked me a lot of questions in recent weeks about what albums to get by specific bands. And I think what you need to do, I've done a bunch of top hard rock and prog albums of the 70s and what have you. And I did like three or four of those. And you should go watch those because there I list a lot of my top albums from a lot of these bands. And you should check those out. That's the best place to go. But right here for right now, so Leaf Hound, you got to get their first album, Growers of Mushroom. That's killer. From Armageddon, they only ever had one album. It's the self-titled album. And from Toad had, I think, three studio albums, but the first is my favorite. It's also self-titled. So I'm assuming you went and listened to samples of these bands and you like what you heard. I'm assuming you don't have them. So that's my assumption. So those are three albums you should get by those bands. From Ivan Hosian, hey, I greatly appreciate the effort you put in your videos and the fact that you attempt to answer all questions. Since you've been talking a lot about classic, hard-hitting Anglo-Canadian bands lately, like April Wine, Mahogany Rush, etc., I'd like to hear your thoughts on more sophisticated Quebec-y bands like Ménage, Harmonium, Opus 5, and Contraction. Okay, I have some stuff by those bands. So I have the Contre Current, however you say that, from Opus 5. That's quite good. Like that quite a bit. From Ménage, I have a Libre Service, which is also a very fine album. really classy stuff. From Harmonium, I have Leheptad, Si on avat beson de una cinamique saison. I don't know, however you say that. Those are both really good. I like those quite a bit. And from, in fact, I think I have a third Harmonium album. I can't think of the title, but Harmonium is very, very good. And from Contraction, I have their self-titled album from 72, which is also pretty cool, kind of fusion-y, avant-garde type of stuff. Good bands. Good, a lot of good Canadian progressive rock bands from that era. From Tarkin Hoskins, hi Pete, great channel. Can't imagine how you find the time to do everything. Either can I. A band that seems to have fallen off the radar is Shadow Gallery. Great melodic prog metal with brilliant vocal harmonies. Any opinions? Yeah, I talked about them a couple weeks ago on another show. I always like Shadow Gallery. I have all their albums on CD. One of the most important of those like 90s prog metal bands that came out in the wake of Dream Theater, and a staple of the Magna Carta label, which pumped out a lot of good bands and albums in that time frame. And I always thought Shadow Gallery were one of the best, really talented guys. I actually met a handful of them, and because they were from Pennsylvania, and they were hanging out at one of the Near Fest that I attended, and really nice guys, and great musicians, great songs, great albums, very underrated, I think. And if, like a lot of people, I talk about some of the best like prog metal of the last like 25 years. I mean, Shadow Gallery's got a handful of them that should be on that list. From Alex Hamilton, hey Pete, these questions and answer sessions are awesome. Glad you like the greatest show on earth. I downloaded their albums a few months ago. They are really cool. What do you think of the British band Bakerloo? I have their album, and I'm convinced Tony Iommi got some of his inspiration for Warning from their song Son of Moonshine. What do you think? Second question, have you heard of the band Comus? Apparently the leader of Opeth, sorry I don't know his name, is a big fan. Very strange band. What do you think? All right, so back to Bakerloo. I had not heard of Bakerloo before, but I went and listened to that album. That's pretty good. I didn't know Clem Clemson, the lead guitar and vocals. It's a trio. It's very bluesy, kind of power trio, kind of creamish, kind of, I don't know. I did, you know, a little bit of early Fleetwood Mac and stuff. I dig it. A couple of really good tunes on there. As far as like Iommi getting inspiration from Son of Moonshine, I mean, the song doesn't really sound like it. Some of the tones, I think, are a little similar. It's just a long, jammy kind of blues rock tune, which I think is pretty cool. But some nice fuzz guitar tones from Clem on there. I dig it. I'm going to have to pick that up. Thanks for that recommendation. As far as Comus, I have the Comus debut CD. That is weird, right? I know Mikael Akerfeldt from Opeth is really big into them. That's an odd curiosity in my collection. I bought it because it's so like legendary and kind of progressive rock and folk lore. But it's not something I've listened to in a while, and I can't say that since I bought it, I've listened to it a ton. Because it is very odd. It's got its moments, but it's definitely not for the faint of heart. From William Gainford, no mention of Ty Tabor, most underrated Axeman ever. Can you do a show on cover versions that are better than the originals? Diamonds and Rust, Green Man Alicia by Priest, for example, way better than the original versions. Manfred Mann, Blinded by the Light is way better than Springsteen's. Motorhead's version of Beer Drinkers is, in my opinion, even better than ZZ Top's. Whoa, hold on there. I like the Motorhead version, but man, that ZZ Top original is great, dude. Come on. But yeah, your other mentions, absolutely. I think I have on my list of things to do a cover versions that are better than the originals show. So that when I get to that, I don't know, but it's on the list to do. As far as Ty Tabor, great guitar player. I'm just not a huge King's X fan. It's one of those bands that everybody always says to me, I can't believe you don't love King's X. I don't dislike them. They just never really grabbed me. I don't know what it is. I think it's Doug's vocals. I just never really warmed up to his vocals. But I always thought Ty is a great guitar player. Absolutely agree with you there. From Jamie Laszlo. What's up, Jamie? I assume you're aware of the band Soen, since their drummer Martin Lopez used to play drums for Opeth. I always thought their first three albums were lacking a certain something to make them better than just okay, but I find their new album Lotus, with its production, guitar work, and lush melodies, to be absolutely stunning. Have you heard this album? What are your thoughts? I haven't heard the new one, Jamie. I've heard, I think, two of their first couple, and I dug them. I didn't think they were great. Like I didn't like them enough to go out and buy them to own them. I agree with you. I thought that there was missing a little something, but still really solid. So, but I have heard from a couple people that the new one is quite excellent. So I probably need to go check that out. From John Bernard, hey Pete, wondering if you ever heard of a band called Circus from the UK. They only released one album in 69 titled Circus. Excuse me. Mel Collins was in the band before Crimson. You have to give them a listen. Their music is prog, psychedelic jazz, fusion. They do an awesome cover of Norwegian Wood, a Must Listen. Yeah, I've had that for years. That's a very, very solid album. I like that. There was actually, there was two bands from that era called Circus. And I think one, S-C-I-R-C-U-S, and the other, I think, had a K in there, C-I-R-K. They were also really good. But yeah, this, that's a very good album. Mel Collins, awesome. Awesome. So anything he was involved in, I would always try and scoop up. That's a good, well worth seeking out album, guys, if you haven't heard it. From Mr. Time Lord 1, how do you feel about bands recording, re-recording their classic albums like Manowar has done a few times? Dude, have you not watched the last couple episodes? I think I answered this one last week. Why bother, right? I know sometimes bands do it when they get a new singer or whatever, and they go and they revisit old albums and, you know, re-record either classic songs or their albums. I know Saxon did it, and, you know, Manowar obviously has done it. Other band, you know, Journey has re-recorded old. I mean, Foreigner did it. A lot of bands do it. You know, whatever. It's like worth a listen, but we all love the originals, right? So I don't understand why bands do it, but I, you know, maybe it's a cash thing. Who knows? From David Mitchell. Hey, Pete. Dave Mitchell here. How about a band that came out of Newburgh, New York named Trigger in the late 70s? Recommended by Gene Simmons, who got them a deal on Casablanca Records. Not a bad record with a few good songs, but like you usually say, nothing that was going to set the world on fire. A friend of mine actually had their first record that they recorded in a studio in Newburgh. Again, after listening to it, nothing that really got me excited, probably due to the substandard sonics of the recording. I remember seeing them in a club back in the early 80s in Middletown, New York, doing a few songs from the Trigger album with a bunch of covers sprinkled throughout their set. Have you heard any more about the guys in the band? I'm sure you've seen the Rock Candy Records remastered album back in 2009. If you're going to see Stars and Angel, Poughkeepsie at the chance, how about a brief review of the show, Rock On? I didn't go last night. I mean, I went to Dream Theater the other night, and two shows in a week is not usually for me. I would have liked to, though. I love both Stars and Angel. I grew up in the Hudson Valley, so of course I heard Trigger played all over the place. But they were not from Newburgh. Maybe one of their members might have grown up around here, but they were a New Jersey band. They were all from New Jersey, or at least three of the guys in the band were from New Jersey. I don't know, maybe one of the guys lived in Newburgh, but they were a New Jersey band. But they played around here quite a bit. They played all over the Jersey Shore and throughout New Jersey and the Hudson Valley. And if I'm not mistaken, I think they recorded that demo album before they got signed to Casablanca. There was an old recording and rehearsal studio in Newburgh that's actually not far from my house. It's not open anymore. It's not there anymore. But I remember like in the late 70s, the 80s, or I think it was still around the early 90s, a lot of people used that. That's probably the place where they recorded that demo album. I remember Trigger played all over the place back in the day. From Robert Griffin. Do you like the band Vallejo? I had never heard them before. I went and listened to a bunch of their tunes. Kind of like modern hard rock and metal with a Santana feel. Interesting. Not bad. From Tony Westell. Hey, Pete. Not so many women in rock. Loved Curve Air. Vinegar Joe. Stone the Crows. Your thoughts, please. From Tony in the UK. Stone the Crows were great. I mean, Maggie Bell. What a talent, right? If you like Janis Joplin, man. Maggie Bell. And then you had some great guitar work from... drawing a blank on his name. He was the brother of Alex Harvey's brother, right? Yeah. Alex Harvey's brother from the sensational Alex Harvey band. He actually got electrocuted. Sad state. Also, James Dewar, bassist and vocals for Robin Trower for many years, also got his start in Stone the Crows. He's on, I think, the first album or two. Jimmy McCullough, later of Paul McCartney Wings, was also in Stone the Crows. Really good blues rock man. With sensational female vocals. Curved Air. I don't have a lot of Curved Air stuff. I have a couple Curved Air albums. Another really good kind of British prog band with female vocals. Very solid stuff. They usually had some good keyboards and violin on their tunes. Vinegar Joe I am not familiar with, so I can't comment on that. From Scott McGregor. Hey, Pete, I'm going to go a different route with music inquiries this time. Give me your top five or more music biographies. Also using this as a reminder, if you haven't yet picked up the Bill Graham biography, also the Miles Davis autobiography, in my own words, is excellent. Second question, what are some of the musicians, bands outside of Miles Davis that got you investigating non-electric jazz or big bands? Cheers. For me, I'll tackle your second one first. Besides from Miles, what other artists got me into non-electric jazz? Coltrane really got me into, you know, kind of the non-fusion stuff, the earlier stuff, as well as I got really into Art Blakey. And the Jazz Messengers for a while. I really liked that kind of stuff. But I have some Benny Goodman stuff. What else? Charlie Parker. That's all great stuff, all classic early jazz, right? As far as like rock biographies, some of my favorites, I got so many of them. I picked a bunch out of my top of my head, but now I'm looking at my stack over here and I'm like, so many great ones. But anyway, Glenn Hughes's book, which was called Glenn Hughes, The Autobiography. Awesome. Old God's Almost Dead by Stephen Davis about the Rolling Stones. Great. Heavy Load by David Clayton. That's all about Free. Great. It's almost like a biography of the sad life of it talks more. Oh, Jesus. Paul Kossoff. Jesus. One of those. It's a long show, guys. Hammer of the Gods by Stephen Davis, obviously about Led Zeppelin. Moon, Keith Moon book by Tony Fletcher. It's great. Room Full of Mirrors. Charles Cross about Jimi Hendrix. Black Sabbath, Symptom of the Universe by Mick Wall. That's a great Sabbath book. Led Zeppelin, All the Albums, All the Songs by Martin Popoff. That's not so much a biography, it's more of a biography of their music, but fantastic book. So that's just some, right? There's so many good ones. I mean, definitely, who asked this question? Scott. What you got to do, Scott, is go into my rants playlist. I did, I think, 3 rant videos where I just talked a lot about some of the rock biographies and autobiographies I've read the last few years. And those are lengthy, and I talk about a lot of them. So definitely go check those out. From Marvel Fan 45, you're here again, Marvel Fan. I recently started listening to Frank Zappa. Don't have any CDs of his, and I need some album recommendations. Can you possibly give me some? Marvel Fan, why are you not watching these shows? I did this for another viewer like 2 weeks ago. All right, One Size Fits All, Apostrophe, Roxy and Elsewhere, Grand Wazoo, and Overnight Sensation. That's what I tell everybody. If they're new to Zappa, investigate those first. All right, you can't miss with those albums. From Nick Yusufian. I doubt you'll notice this, but ask anyway. You said you have 2 iPods worth of music. If you had to guess or you're aware, how many gigs does your collection have? With that gargantuan collection, it's probably huge. Keep rocking. P.S. Spike's song by Frank Abagnale is a great tune. Ah, you must have listened to me on Jeff Young's Music Without Boundaries show, right? That was my first appearance. We played Spike's song. It's a great tune. I have 2. I have 1 iPod, 160 gig iPod that is full. Okay? So right there, that's, I think, it says 160 gigs, but you really can only put like 147 gigs worth of music. So one has got full. The other one is probably like, maybe it's half full. Maybe it's 3/4. It's about half full. So that right there is, let's say 80 or 70, right? So right there, I've got probably about 210 or 20 gigs worth of music. And that's not everything, obviously. So I would think if I were to take like all my music and put it on a couple iPods, you're probably talking, 400 gigs worth of music. I don't know. I'm just guessing. I have no idea. It's a lot of stuff. From Robert Adamind X. My question has been overlooked the last 2 times and I do not understand why. Oh, the travesty of it all. I have 1 question. So I only had 1 question, so I'm changing it. Okay. Have you ever heard of bands like Orison Space Collective, Hedraea Space Folk, and various other space rock bands? If so, what is your take on them? I've actually talked about Orison Space Collective and Hedraea Space Folk before. I like them. They kind of remind me of like a little different Osric Tentacles type of thing. And I like Hawkwind and I dig space rock. I think it's pretty cool. There's just so many bands out there, right? So I don't know all of them, but I have a couple Orison Space Collective albums and I believe I have 1 Hedraea Space Folk. Good stuff. I like them. Good stuff. From Marvel Fan 45 is back again. What are the best Journey and Styx albums? Marvel Fan, you're killing me today. Remember guys, try to limit to 1 question per week if you can. Best Journey albums, depends on what you're into. The first 3, Journey, Look Into the Future, and Next, are very cool. That's their kind of like prog fusion period, all right? A lot of instrumental stuff. Steve Perry joins the band. You got him sharing vocals with Greg Raleigh. So Infinity, Evolution, Departure are really good albums. And Escape, sorry. No, not Escape, I'm sorry. Infinity, Evolution, and Departure, really good. That's like the kind of the intro to the Steve Perry years. The mega years, obviously, were Escape and Frontiers. A lot of hit singles on those albums. And then I really liked the last studio album they did with Arnel Pineda called Eclipse. That's more of like kind of like a hard rock album, but really good, memorable tunes. I like. So those are my favorite Journey albums, but feel free to try any of them depending on what you like. As far as Styx goes, Pieces of 8, The Grand Illusion, Crystal Ball, Equinox, The new one, The Mission, or the latest one, The Mission, is fantastic. Man of Miracles is great. It's really old, early. The Serpent is Rising, really good. A lot of great Sticks albums. There's more than that, but those are good ones to start with. From Dude Why, hey Pete, do you like Head East? Yes, I do. I own Flaz of Pancake and A Different Kind of Crazy, good U.S. hard rock band. Dig them. I know that they have more. A lot of their stuff is out of print, though, but I like them a lot. Good and good, catchy anthems on those. From Mark Williams, hey Pete, great show as always. Are you aware of the supergroup Sun Red Sun? Great self-titled album around 93 or 94 with Ray Gillen, Chris Caffey, Bobby Rondinelli, Mike Starr, and John McCoy. Great album. What's your take on, and also what's your take on the Neil Schon solo albums? I don't own the Sun Red Sun, but that is good stuff. Pretty short. You know, Ray Gillen, man, what a talent. He just sounds awesome on that album. As far as like a Neil Schon solo stuff, I have Late Night, which is first. That's really good. Kind of mellow and jazzy in spots, but it's got some fire. I dig it. Beyond the Thunder is very good. And his most, is it the most recent one? Vortex? Not sure if that's the most recent one, but that's quite good too. I love Neil. What an amazing, amazing player, unique player. Nobody like him. Just underrated beyond belief. You know, a lot of people, I think, just because he was in the Hit Machine journey, right? They tend to forget about what a great guitar player he is. Love him. From August West, howdy Pete. Recently, a few friends and I were talking, and questions came up. Who is your favorite guitarist still alive? Really tough question for me, but I was leaning towards Pete Townsend. How about you? Wishing you well, and yes, I love this show. Good, August. But did you not watch last week's show? I think I talked about my top five favorite guitar players, and they're all still alive. Richie Blackmore is my favorite guitar player of all time. He's still alive. So you know, Blackmore. Actually, no, my number three favorite guitar player is passed on. That's Gary Moore. Sorry. So I misspoke. My favorite guitar players of all time are Blackmore, Tony Iommi, Gary Moore, Michael Schenker, and number five. God, number five could be anybody. You know, Robin Trower, Frank Marino, Jimi Hendrix, Steve Morse. But those top four, man. Uli John Roth, another one. From Tate Davis, another great show, my friend. My question this week involves the band Buffalo from Australia. I've been looking to get into them since you mentioned them in a recent video. What's the best album to start for a first-time listener of this band? Again, I have talked about Buffalo many times before. In fact, you got to go back to go into the playlist, under the history of playlist. I've got a couple of top hard rock, metal, and prog albums of the 70s, and I got a couple of underground shows. I talked about Buffalo. Volcanic Rock is the one to get. Okay, that's Buffalo had a couple albums, but that's probably their most well-known one, and probably their best. Arguably, they have another. The one that came after is also really good too. But Volcanic Rock is a great one to start with. Heavy album. From Kenny Ritchie, hey Pete, just discovered the band Nightwish from Finland. If you've never heard of them, check them out live at Wacken. Have you heard? If you've heard of them, who was your favorite singer they had? Kenny, I just talked about Nightwish last week. God, you guys are not watching these shows. Yeah, I've been listening to Nightwish for a long time. I like Flora Jansen the best as well. I think I always kind of had an issue with Tarja. She's got a beautiful voice, but it's just so operatic. I can only listen to so much of her. But Flora Jansen is just great because she can kind of do a lot of different styles. So, but yeah, you know, Annette was good too. I liked Annette. I saw them live with Annette. I thought Annette was good. From Bongalong, I love analog keyboards, especially from the early 70s prog. Can you suggest some newer bands that are recording retro-sounding albums, hopefully using analog instruments? Yes, check out Wobbler from Norway. If you have not heard Wobbler, you absolutely must do that as soon as you stop watching this show. Wobbler are awesome, and they use all analog equipment, Mellotrons and Moogs and all you know, Fender Rhodes and you name it. They use it. The Night Watch, what do they call themselves now? The Night Watch or The Watch? I forget what they call themselves now. They're from Italy. They kind of like do like a vintage Genesis meets King Crimson thing. Very, very cool. Anglergard from Sweden, obviously. Bongalong, if you haven't heard of Anglergard, shame on you, man. They came out in the early mid-90s, and they kind of went on hiatus for quite a bit, then came back and did some live shows, put out another album. I think they're on hiatus again, but man, definitely Anglergard, all right, from Sweden. Black Bonzo from Sweden, they're not around anymore, but their first like three albums are great, you know, kind of more prog meets like Uriah Heep style heavy rock with lots of Hammond organ and Mellotron. Okay, really good stuff. Big Elf, another band that I haven't heard from in a while, but they do more of kind of like The Move, okay, real kind of like, you know, the Move meets the Beatles type of thing with a little bit of Heap and Purple in there. So lots of Hammond and Moog and Mellotron or Moog, sorry, Moog and Mellotron, with like nice pop hooks and things like that. And, you know, big guitar riffs, very, very cool. They're from the U.S. And also Astra or Astra, A-S-T-R-A from the U.S. They're very cool kind of proggy, space rocky type of stuff with lots of analog keyboard goodness. There's some ones to check out. From Matty Boy Walker, which lineup of Journey do you prefer, the Jonathan Cain years or Greg Raleigh? I think both lineups made amazing music, but I always find myself listening to Infinity, Departure, and Evolution more so than Escape and Frontiers. Different sound, more bluesy, more Hammond organ, bluesy guitar work from Sean and Raleigh. I don't think some of those songs are appreciated enough, and everyone goes for Escape and Frontiers material. Your thoughts? I mean, I like them both. You know, if you were to ask me, I can only take those earlier years or the 80s stuff. I probably would take the earlier stuff. There's a lot of great tunes on those, you know, Infinity, Departure and stuff. Great albums. And but the others are great too, you know. I mean, shit. Escape and Frontiers, damn good albums. But yeah, I'd probably take the 70s ones. But yeah, it's, you know. And I always like, as far as like keyboard players go, I like Greg Raleigh better. He's just, because I'm a Hammond organ guy. Nothing against Jonathan Cain. He's a great player too. And he could play the Hammond organ. He chose not to do it. You know, Hammond organ stuff wasn't really big in the 80s. It was more about synths and things like that and piano. But yeah. Yeah, I'd probably go for the Greg Raleigh era. But it's tough because it's both great. From Allajack79 Johnston. Why is it, do you think, that when a member of a good band leaves and just isn't as successful as a solo artist? Fish, for example, said his tickets just don't sell anymore. He may have to call it a day. Blaze Blazely, solo stuff is awesome, but he plays to no more than about 100 or so people. Steve Harris's British Lion sounded like Bon Jovi. Didn't sell well. Also, Paul Di'Anno struggled after Maiden, even though he did some good stuff. Any of the Stone stuff doesn't sell, even though I thought Mick's last solo album, Goddess in the Doorway, was great. Keith called it dog shit in the doorway. Paul Rodgers outside of Free and Bad Company. Why do you think that is? Well, because people remember the bands, right? And anything, take away all the individual parts, there, you know, there's exceptions, right? You know, obviously Ozzy did very well for himself away from Black Sabbath. You know, Ronnie James Dio did very well for himself away from Black Sabbath and Rainbow. But that's not the norm. A lot of these bands, they, you know, like, I'm not a fan, but, you know, Vince Neil had a little bit of success after he left Motley Crue and did some solo stuff, but that was quick and that was it, you know? You know, Slash has not been able to duplicate the success of when he was with Guns N' Roses, even though, you know, he does okay for himself. But, you know, Fish, you know, first of all, let's be honest, Marillion were never a really big band, right? So you take Fish out of that band, right? And it's a very specialized segment of fans or followers that are going to follow someone like Fish. And a lot of those Fish solo albums are very decent. A couple of them are really good, and some of them are kind of like, eh, right? So it has a lot to do with that. Sometimes the magic of when the band was together, that's what people want and crave and remember. And then when you take a singer leaves, tries to do his own thing, it's like they remember, you know, look at Jeff Tate for crying out loud. So he leaves Queensryche. There's this big fight, whatever he's done, and he has released, you know, half a dozen solo records, or, you know, other than Operation Mindcrime name or whatever, and nobody's buying that stuff, right? So it's, you know, they want, and you I hear it all the time, they want to see him back in Queensryche. But, you know, Queensryche has a very capable singer now playing music like classic Queensryche, and just it was time to move on. You know, like if Fish were to go back into Marillion right now, that wouldn't make any sense, right? So I don't know. I think people just they want to hear that singer in that band playing those classic songs. And, you know, a lot of times the singers leave and they don't want to do those songs. They want to do their new stuff. And people are just like, not interested. So it's hard. It's hard. From Miguel Oliveira. Hey, Pete, fantastic channel and keep it going. Love your enthusiasm about music. Can you do a top 10 for Pink Floyd? What are your favorite prog rock singers? I guess you didn't watch my little announcement 2 weeks ago. Yes, Pink Floyd top 10 is on the horizon. We'll get to it at some point. My favorite prog rock singers of all time. Peter Gabriel, Neil Morris, John Anderson from Yes, Greg Lake, John Wetton, Stephen Wilson, Ian Anderson from Tull. Old Ian Anderson from Tull, not the more recent stuff. He kind of lost his voice. Classic Phil Collins from, you know, the late 70s. Geddy Lee, Derek Shulman from Gentle Giant. Those are some of my favorites. From Drum Music, Inc. Pete, love your channel. Have you heard anything from the band The Watchers? full album called The Black Abyss, mixed by Max Norman. Also have an EP called Sabbath Highway. Excellent stoner rock band from my neck of the woods in the San Francisco Bay Area. Keep up the good work. I hadn't heard of them, and I went and listened to that album. That's pretty damn good. I dig it. Doomy stoner stuff. Big riffs. Awesome. From John Blade. Hey, Pete, really some great questions and answers episodes. What are your thoughts on Beth Hart? Really good soulful vocalist. Yeah, she's awesome. She is. She can sing, man. And she, Beth has this, she just like, it's not like Beth is like the most beautiful woman on the planet, but she just, everything about her just oozes sexuality. And it just comes through in her music. So it's kind of like this bluesy kind of, you know, I don't know. It's hard to describe. She's a great singer. Got great range. I love the stuff she's done with Joe Bonamassa. I like a lot of her solo stuff, especially the earlier stuff. And man, you know, I've never seen her live. I would love to, because she really puts it all in a live performance. So great. Awesome. She's really good. Also, thoughts on Detective. Great first album. Second, not as good. Well, obviously, I already answered the Detective question from someone else earlier. Also, have you ever heard Last Crack Burning Time from 1991? You should check them out. Killer guitar work. Keep up the good work. Yeah, I mean, that's a really good album. That's a band that kind of fell under the radar for me, and I think a lot of people. But their debut album and that album is pretty damn good. It's different. A lot of great guitar work. It's kind of metal, kind of proggy, you know? Definitely different. I don't know why those bands weren't bigger than they were, right? And last question from Peter Brickley. Hey, Pete, which do you like better, Thor or Gwar? How about neither? I could care less about either one of them. I mean, Gwar were kind of fun to see live, you know, back in the day when they were still doing their thing. I think they still are. Maybe they are after the vocalist passed away. But, I saw them at a, was it Sounds of the Underground Festival or something like that. It was kind of fun, I guess, you know, kind of a fun experience. But I have no interest in their music at all. And Thor, pretty much the same thing. No interest. Sorry. I will choose neither one of them. So that brings to end another questions and answers show. Might be our longest one yet. Holy moly. So remember, guys, the format's going to change for the next one. We're going to do a maximum of 10 questions. So make your questions good. Remember, I am not going to answer any more questions about Pete, can you do a show on this band? Pete, can you do a show on that band? Pete, who do you think is more overrated or underrated? All that kind of stuff. Make these questions good. All right. I like questions where I can actually think and come up with a honest, thoughtful answer, all right, which has to do with the music we love. So, you know, there's some good ones in this episode. I give you guys credit. You had some good ones and some not so good ones. And, you know, if you guys aren't, and, you know, and I get a lot of people who send me messages saying, hey, how come you're never answering my questions? Like, well, how come you're not watching the videos? Because I've answered that question like 2-3 times already over the last couple of weeks. Watch these episodes, because if nobody's watching, you know, I see the thousands of people watching, but then I keep getting the same questions over the time. So I'm wondering if people are actually paying attention or not. So I don't know. All right. I'm happy to do these, but we've got to make it more focused. So we're shooting for half-hour shows going forward. 10 questions. That's it. So put your question in the comments, and I'll check them out. I'm going to be away for a week on business, so you're not going to see anything from me all of next week, or at least most of next week. We'll come back next weekend, hopefully squeeze something in, but then it's Easter and all that kind of stuff. So the next like couple of weeks are going to be a little slow on content, but you guys have plenty of it here on the channel to check out, so do that. This is on the web at www.citytranquility.org. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter. Of course, we're on the Mighty YouTube often. We'll see you again real soon, guys. So enjoy this episode, and take care. See you soon.